Welcome to virtual worship from First Evangelical Lutheran Church in Poughkeepsie, New York. I am Lisa Stevens, one of the worship leaders here, and today is October 25th, 2020, which happens to be Reformation Sunday. So welcome to everybody, and especially our people joining us for the first time. So I thought I would share, before we get started, just a couple things about Reformation Sunday and why it is that Lutherans have this special day in their calendar. So Reformation Sunday gives us a chance to remember our story, remember our history, especially theologically, what it was that Luther was teaching and why it made such a change in the church. Reformation Sunday also reminds us of the things that are really important, right? And that is that God loves us unconditionally. And finally, Reformation Sunday challenges us to keep reforming, to keep doing better. So as we continue on to celebrate Reformation Sunday, remember those things. And now we will move on to our confession. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation. Amen. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God hears the cries of all who call out in need, and through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims, our sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel. And bestow on the church your saving grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first lesson comes from the 31st chapter of Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke. Though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Here ends the lesson.
You read Psalm 46 responsively. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore we will not fear, through the earth be moved, and through the mountains shake in the depths of the sea.
Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be shaken. God shall help it break of the day.
The nations rage and the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Come now, regard the works of the Lord. What desolations God has brought upon the earth.
Behold the ones who make to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields of fire.
Be still then and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
The second lesson comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 3. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes knowledge of sin. But now, apart from law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he has passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. Here ends the second lesson.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Holy Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. For my day job, I am a chemistry professor. And as most of you also know, that the last 18 months for teachers has been very difficult. One of the interesting things that's happened and that's come out of this pandemic is that there are now two groups, and probably more, but two that I'm involved in on social media, specifically for chemistry educators everywhere, to ask questions, to get support, to tell geeky science jokes, and to try to survive teaching chemistry during a pandemic. I bring this up because a few days ago, one of my colleagues in a different college posted an urgent request. She is a department chair, and one of her chemistry faculty members was suddenly hospitalized, and it came down from upper administration that it was up to her to get his class covered. The course was not something she ever teaches. There was no useful syllabus. There wasn't even a roadmap of topics to be covered. There were no old exams. There was nothing to help her figure out either how to help someone else take over the course or for her to be able to turn around and teach the course herself. So she posted this information in one of these chemistry teacher groups and received an outpouring of offers of help, from videos to use, to old exams, to syllabi, etc. The next day, there was a second post from this professor. She mentioned she felt that she had been criticized by someone for asking for free help and not offering compensation for someone's intellectual property. That was an incorrect interpretation of the message she received, as it turned out, but that wasn't the part that struck me. What struck me is that in response to this post, over and over again, the people who had sent her materials responded with, "I shared this with you as a gift, not because I expected you to pay me for it." So this is where, if we were in a church building and this was live, I'd be looking out over the congregation and seeing the light bulbs starting to click on as you figure out how I am bringing teaching chemistry and using social media to church and Reformation Sunday. I'm going to say again the words that caught my attention. I shared this with you as a gift, not because I expected you to pay for it. Similar words were a church-shattering revelation from God through scripture that Martin Luther was trying to get across to the church of his time. Words that the Holy Spirit is still working to get us to hear every day. Words that remind us that our salvation is a gift from God with no expectation for payment from us. A gift of unconditional love. In the letter from Paul to the Romans, we hear, "Since all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, they are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." A gift. A gift where we are both justified and redeemed, pardoned for our sins, and set free from being slaves to sin. Jesus' own words talk about that redemption. Everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. If the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. Now I'm just going to take a little side trip detour here, especially with everything that's happening in this country right now. I want to make it very clear that the biblical use of the word slave is not the same as the kidnapping of Africans from their lands by white Europeans and Americans hundreds of years ago and relegating them to being less than human and property. Biblically, the term slave is more in line with the idea of being a servant or an indentured servant. Still not a great position, but it wasn't the same as what we think of in terms of slaves and the enslavement of Africans. There's a whole sermon that could be preached on that, which I will not do today, but I just wanted to be sure that as I continue to use this term slave through the sermon, that we are on the same page about what it means biblically and what it means in these passages. So in doing some reading for this sermon, I came across an article written by the Reverend Dr. Mark Tranvik. He's an ELCA pastor and a seminary professor. He calls attention to two words in Romans that could easily be overlooked. In fact, I actually did overlook them, but that he thinks we should really pay attention to. These words are the first two words of Romans 3:21. The words are, "but now." Dr. Tranvik writes, "But now, says Paul, God is doing something new. Paul is directing our attention to the present tense. This is echoed later in the section when he says, they are now justified by his grace. And it was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous. In other words, we are not dealing merely with something that God has done in the past. This is not a glance back to a once upon a time. It is certainly not merely a history lesson. Paul's point is that right now, this very moment, God is declaring something to us that we need to hear. In other words, this is a message that connects with people's lives as they live today. End quote. So verses 19 and 20 make it very clear that even if we wanted to, there is nothing we could do on our own to be justified in God's sight. But God's love, God's grace, our redemption, our justification started from our own beginning and will continue through eternity. We weren't forgiven and set free 2,000 or so years ago. We are forgiven and set free every second of every minute of every day for eternity. You've probably heard the phrase, the gift that keeps on giving. Well, this truly is the gift that keeps on giving. And it is that gift that we highlight as often as we can, but especially on Reformation Sunday. I have shared another story with many of you, and so my apologies for those who have already heard it, but I'm going to share it with everyone here. A year ago this week, I was sitting at dinner with my husband, who is an ELCA pastor, but currently serving a couple of Episcopalian churches in addition to the National Guard. I asked him on that last week of October in 2019 what he was going to do for church, for Reformation Sunday. And he simply looked at me and replied, "Nothing. Anglicans don't do Reformation Sunday." My response very quickly was, "Well then, I guess I won't be going to church with you." And on Reformation Sunday 2019, I walked into First Lutheran Church for the very first time. And boy, what a first year I have had with you all. This memory came back to me as we started to approach the fall, and it started me wondering, why did it matter to me to go to a Lutheran church on Reformation Sunday? I'm sure my husband would have preached a fine non-Reformation Sunday sermon, and the liturgy would have been familiar. After all, the Anglican and the Lutheran services really aren't all that different. But I had been wandering in a desert for some time. I had been away from church completely for a few months after having left my position as a music minister. I was mourning the loss of a musical partnership that had led to a special friendship. That friendship still exists, but the musical partnership dissolved when we both resigned from our position. And I wanted to finally go somewhere that felt like a spiritual home. And on Reformation Sunday, that home could not have been in any church that was not Lutheran. I needed a place where I could remember where I came from spiritually, refocus on what is most important, and be challenged to keep reforming my spiritual life and practices. So those three things should sound a little bit familiar to my introduction and welcome earlier. So having a place to belong is a powerful need for humans. Our gospel speaks right to the heart of that. Jesus flatly says that if we sin, we are slaves to sin. And with a deeper blow, Jesus reminds us that slaves do not have a permanent place in the household. In other words, sinners don't belong. And we know that we are all sinners. But the good news is that Jesus didn't end his discourse there. The beauty of what Luther was trying to point out after reading his Bible carefully and what Jesus says in our gospel lesson today is that yes, we are slaves to sin and cannot free ourselves, but Jesus can. He does free us every second of every minute of every day for eternity. Through Jesus' willingness to be clothed in our sins, we are justified and forgiven. We are redeemed and free. We belong. We have a place in God's household always. This is a gift, no expectation of payment. It is a gift. It is up to you to decide what to do with that gift. But the great thing about this particular gift, the more you share, the greater it becomes. Amen.
Let us firm our faith together by saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. he descended to hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen.
Prayers of Intercession. With confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the Church, the world, and all those in need. Renew and inspire the Church in the freedom of the gospel, O God. Where the Church is in error, reform it. Where the Church speaks your truth, strengthen it. Where the Church is divided, unify it. Ignite in us the working of the Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As the earth changes, as mountains shake and the waters roar, may we care for this planet as a holy habitation for all the living things. Sustain all peoples and lands recovering from natural disasters of any kind. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide areas of the world divided or traumatized by conflict, especially in our own land. Free all from slavery and human trafficking, and protect all in harm's way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Release those living in bondage to debt, chronic pain, or addiction. Grant healing touch to those who are ill. We pray for all who are suffering from any of the effects of the pandemic. Bless the scientists who are working to find a vaccine and strengthen doctors, medical care workers, and caregivers who see to the needs of those who are ill. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this family of faith, we give thanks for courageous voices that have remained firm in their commitment to the one who frees us from sin and death. Centered in your grace, unify us in the hope of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We continue to pray for Renata and for Judy. We pray for Kevin's sister, Mary, and for Ricky's sister, Renata. We also pray for Kurt's mother, Lisa's mother, Barbara's mother, for Alice and Hans, for Carol, and for Gao Jing. Be with Sherry in her healing, and Jean as she recovers from a broken hip. Our prayers remain with all those among our immediate and extended church families who serve in medical settings: Nancy, Donna, Erica, Henry, Laura, Ryan, and Terry, Chaplain Kelly Ray at Lutheran Care. We pray for the Trivedi family in India, for Linda's friend Sally, for Anne's niece and for her brothers, for Sally's mother Brantley, for Maureen and Frank, Taryn and Chris, and Tom and Phil. We pray also for Ricky's other sister and for Scott's sister. We continue to pray for Eddie, Richard, and David, and Dale and Dave, each according to their needs. We pray, too, for the comfort of Dale's family as they mourn the death of their mother, Rose. We remember in our prayers today Erna and Michael, Tan Su, Eunice, Louise, Jean, Alice, Mary, and Eleanor, Adele's friend Anne, and Linda's cousin Sandy. We pray for Colin as he deploys overseas and for his family as they support him long distance, for all members of our military together with their families and loved ones, and for the chaplains who minister to them, including Lisa's husband, Anthony. And we pray for our Bishop Paul, assistant to the Bishop Chris, and for our presiding Bishop Elizabeth, for St. John's Lutheran Church and for the Lutheran Care Center, Dutchess County Interfaith Council, our ecumenical partners, including the World Council of Churches, and for the Church universal. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the ecumenical prayer cycle for today, our sisters and brothers in Christ in Canada and the United States have asked us to join them in praying for churches facing new challenges, that they may continue to witness boldly to the gospel in evolving multicultural and multi-religious and secular contexts. Indigenous peoples in their long struggles for survival, land and rights, and for ongoing healing and reconciliation with those who have come after them. New immigrants, that they will continue to be welcomed in these countries and that policies will serve the common good. Effectively countering systemic greed that exploits communities and natural resources. Government leaders, that they would advance justice, human rights, and peace for all within these countries and in the rest of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Even in death, you free us and give us a place in your house. We give thanks for our ancestors who have shown us truth and freedom, especially Martin Luther and those who work for the renewal of the Church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Listen as we call on you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you. And now please share that peace with everyone that you are with.
Let us pray. O God of justice and love, we give thanks that you illumine our way through life with your word. Give us the light we need, awaken us to the needs of others, and at the last bring your word, all your world, to your feast through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. Let us read the Lord's Prayer together, as our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hear the blessing. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter, bless us and keep us in eternal love. Amen. Go in peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.